Good morning. The first item of business is general questions. In order to get as many members in as possible, I'd be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it offers to businesses in Aberdeen.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Enterprise, our national economic development agency, works with businesses in Aberdeen to create high-value jobs, enable innovation, boost productivity, attract investment. It also helps businesses to internationalise and expand their export opportunities. I was delighted to visit Verloom with the First Minister, a renewable energy company based in Aberdeen, last week to learn how they have benefited from such support from Scottish Enterprise and hear about their future plans. And further to that, the Scottish Government is investing over £125 million in the Aberdeen City Region deal and further supports businesses in the region through initiatives such as the Energy Transition Fund and the Just Transition Fund.
Liam Kerr.
Last week, Aberdeen received the devastating news that M&S is to close just days after we lost Hague's due to difficult trading conditions. Now, recently, Aberdeen business leaders met the government to highlight the impact of its decision not to introduce a 75% rates relief like the one in England. So will the Scottish Government reverse its decision to ignore the demands of businesses, including those in Aberdeen and the witnesses at the Economy Committee this week, who desperately want the 75% rates relief passed on to ensure their businesses are competitive with markets south of the border?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, thank Liam Kerr for that question. And first of all, I have to say that, of course, the decision of Marks & Spencers to close its Union Street store but invest £15 million in doubling its space at Union Square is actually a signal of intent and confidence in the market in Aberdeen, and my understanding is will have no bearing in terms of redundancies. And the decision, the issue regarding non-domestic rates, I don't believe has had any implication on the decision that M&S has taken in order to provide substantial investment. The Deputy First Minister, Tom Arthur, and I had a very productive meeting with the hospitality industry this morning around what is possible around not just non-domestic rates but further work with the sector as well. It follows on from a very productive session with the Scottish Retail Consortium last week, and we'll continue to look at what we can do in order to provide support. But of course, if we had passed on that resource to the hospitality and leisure retail industry, we would have had no further space to invest in public services, and that would have had devastating consequences, as can be seen in England, where we're seeing a real terms cut in the NHS.
Question number two, Maggie Chapman.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its response to the recent Families Outside report, Staying Connected, Care Experienced Children and Young People with a Sibling in Prison or Secure Care.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, keeping siblings connected is fundamental to the Scottish Government's commitment to keeping the promise. I welcome the contribution the Families Outside report has made to helping our understanding of this issue. In 2021, we enacted legislation placing a duty on councils to nurture children's relationships with their siblings when they can't live at home, including where one sibling is in prison. We are taking action to improve our understanding of how children and young people are affected by a family member in prison or secure care through the work led by the Children and Families National Leadership Group. And their final report and summary of follow-on work will be published shortly.
Maggie Chapman.
Thank you. One issue the report highlights is the lack of data. We don't know how many young people have a sibling in prison. We don't understand why multiple siblings might be involved in offending behaviour. We don't routinely keep records of where imprisoned siblings are. The report also states that many families struggle to afford travel for prison visits. Will the Cabinet Secretary meet with me and Families Outside to discuss these and other issues highlighted in the report to suggest potential resolutions?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, data collection is of course important to establishing the national picture and monitoring the implementation of the 2021 legislation. Of course, I would be delighted to meet with Ms Chapman and Families Outside, an organisation that I am well acquainted with. With respect to travel costs, I am aware that many families are finding it difficult to make visits to their loved ones in custody, and while there are some existing supports, we are assessing current issues with partners and will consider practical ways to make travelling to visit family members easier.
Question number three, Sandish Gilhani.
to ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that the MV Isle of Islay will be launched on the 16th of March 2024.
Minister Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government is pleased that work at the Kemmery shipyard on all four vessels continues to progress well and that the MV Isle of Islay will be launched in March this year. I look forward to attending the official naming ceremony due to take place in Scotland later this year, which marks another major milestone in the vessel's construction. When the vessel is delivered in October this year, the communities of Isla and Jura can look forward to a more resilient and modern ferry service.
Sandish Gulhani.
Well, the Turkish-built MV Isle of Isla is on time and on budget only 2 years after being ordered. I assume the First Minister will not be attending this launch with fanfare and fake windows as his predecessor did, but perhaps the Minister will be. Conversely, the handling of the boats being built at the Clyde shipyard under this inept SNP government is utterly shambolic. 3 times over budget, 6 years late and no launch date. This is a complete humiliation for the SNP government. Given the latest saga at Drossen, further letting down islanders, will the Cabinet Secretary now take this opportunity to apologise to islanders for this ferry fiasco, who have been let down, ignored, taken for granted, and provide a guarantee that incompetence of the SNP government's handling of the ferry fiasco will never be repeated?
Minister.
I think the Conservatives can acknowledge that there are going to be 6 vessels delivered supporting our islanders by 2026. £2 billion worth of investment in our ferry service and support for our island communities. Yes, there have been challenges, but I, unlike Mr. Gulhani, will not insult the work of the Ferguson shipyard and their workers, and the fact that they exist enables them to be working
Members.
And completing these vessels. In terms of the issues facing islanders, I have spoken directly to them. They know that the government's concern and have apologised directly to them for the difficulties that they face. But let's face forward, let's welcome those 6 new vessels, and let's not use a positive story about the MV Isle of Isla coming to Scotland this year to be another hook for the Conservatives to bash Ferguson shipyard and not listen to the islanders who want to see these ferries delivered, 6 by 2026.
Briefly, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is an exciting prospect for islanders. Along with the MV Loch Indal, this vessel represents an investment of over £90 million and is proof of the Government's commitment to providing communities with a resilient, reliable ferry service. The new vessel will bring...
Can I please have a question, Ms Dunbar? Thank you. Could you please put your question, Ms Dunbar?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Sorry, I never quite heard you for the chundering. So does the Minister share my view that while it's all very well to play politics, this news and progress in all vessels to improve services for our island communities is something we should all welcome?
Minister.
I agree. I think islanders don't want politics played. They want the vessels delivered. And the MV Isle of Islay and the MV Loch Indal will deliver increased capacity and added resilience, which will benefit both islanders and also businesses. We're investing in replacement vessels across the network, and I look forward to welcoming the 6 new vessels to the fleet by 2026.
Question number 4, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reported comments by the Faculty of Advocates and the Law Society of Scotland that an exodus of defence solicitors has left the legal system close to collapse.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am aware of the issues of concern raised by the Faculty of Advocates and the Law Society, and I established and co-chair the Future of the Legal Profession Working Group with the Chief Executive of the Law Society of Scotland and the Dean of Faculty of Advocates to examine evidence and identify measures we can collectively take to address recruitment and retention within the criminal defence. We also recognise the important role of legal aid providers within the justice system, which is why we have provided significant additional funding and increases in remuneration in recent years, investing £31 million in legal aid since 2021. This is despite the clear and significant constraints on our finances from the UK government settlement. In this financial year, we will provide an £11 million package of legal aid reforms, including an uplift worth 10.2% overall.
Jamie Green.
I have to say to the Minister, this isn't a problem that suddenly appeared this year. This has been a decade-long issue. It's been a long time coming, Minister. There's an estimated 70 defence advocates have left the profession and moved to higher-paid jobs in the Crown Office and Prosecution Service. Unsurprisingly, the Faculty of Advocates describe this as an unprecedented exodus and shortage of solicitors. This leads to trials being delayed and, in some cases, cancelled. The Law Society say that our legal aid sector has been left in the dark without long-lasting reform. I agree. So can I ask the Minister, what is the government doing now to ensure that we do not see our legal sector collapse? Because, as the government often say themselves, justice delayed is justice denied.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government cannot compel private solicitors to undertake work. However, it is expected that the increase in legal aid fees will have a positive impact on availability or recruitment or retention for those seeking advice and representation. Since 2021, there has been an investment of £31 million to legal aid. If there is a continuing problem with recruitment and retention, it would suggest that remuneration is not the only issue and points to a need to innovate in the provision of access to legal services.
Brief supplementary, Pauline McNeill.
Although there has been an increase in fees, this is still a profession that pays less, lawyers less, who work in the sector in relation to the government or the Crown. So it's quite simple to understand. If you don't pay lawyers the same as government lawyers or Crown Office lawyers, then you're not going to attract the talent in the profession. While Scottish Labour welcomes the commitment of the Scottish Government to independent legal representation for victims who are subject to Section 275 in rape trials, the Law Society has already expressed concern how they will fulfil this pledge if it does not resolve the unfair question of how defence lawyers are paid.
Minister.
Thank you. Despite reductions of level on crime, revenue, funding for legal aid and other aspects of the justice system have been maintained in cash terms, and there has been no cash reduction in budget for the legal aid fund. And in addition, the budget is demand-led. And all of those who meet the eligibility criteria have access to legal aid regardless of the allocated budget. The number of civil legal aid cases paid increased by 9%, summary criminal legal aid by 15%, and solemn criminal legal aid by 13%. This is a clear indicator of the work being done to reduce the COVID backlogs across the justice system.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I say that the lack of defence solicitors is a particular problem in rural and island areas, with the falling numbers giving rise to the risk of legal aid deserts in some areas. So what steps will the Minister take to address this specific aspect of the problems rightly highlighted by the Law Society of Scotland?
Minister.
Thank you. Solicitors in all parts of Scotland are able to access funding for the work carried out under the legal assistance schemes. The schemes are also flexible enough to allow solicitors to travel to rural and to remote parts of the country to carry out work should it be possible to instruct a local agent. Although, as I've already reiterated, the Scottish Government cannot compel private solicitors to undertake work. However, it is expected with the increase in legal aid fees, this will have a positive impact on availability and representation.
Question number 5, Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the statistics that it's published in Criminal Justice Social Work for 2022-23.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constant.
Presiding Officer, Justice Social Work do commendable work to ensure that community sentences and other interventions effectively address offending and its causes and provide benefits to local communities. While the pandemic continued to have an impact in 2022-23, the latest Justice Social Work statistics show encouraging signs that community justice services continue to recover. There were 14,700 community payback orders commenced in 2022-23. This is an increase of 20% on the previous year. Bail supervision cases and structured deferred sentences commenced also increased and were both at the highest level in the last 5 years.
Russell Finlay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but what she didn't mention is that almost 5,000 criminals were diverted from prosecution instead of being put in the dock, which is a record high. She also did not say that one in three criminals given community service were not required to do any unpaid work. Put simply, thousands of criminals are not prosecuted and those who are convicted receive no punishment. This morning I spoke with the Scottish Retail Consortium, whose colleagues suffer unacceptable threats and violence every single day. So Cabinet Secretary, tell them and victims across Scotland why they must pay the price for the SNP's relentless weakening of Scotland's criminal justice system.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I know that Mr Finlay doesn't like the facts to get in the way of his narrative or indeed a good old yarn. Yeah. But in terms of community payback orders, he should recognise that since their inception, 10.6 million hours of reparation through unpaid work has been made to our communities, and that is good to reduce reoffending and, of course, ensure our communities are safer. Now, with respect to the issues he raises in and around diversion, I'm quite sure Mr Finlay knows that these are often matters for the independent prosecutors and therefore not matters for ministers. But he should also be aware of the facts that for the first time, unpaid work has been a higher requirement than other supervision requirements in community payback orders. And that, of course, is positive. But he should also know that unpaid work is one of 10 potential requirements in a community payback order. But
thank you, Minister.
As usual, Presiding Officer, Conservatives are soft in substance, soft in solutions.
And thank you, Minister.
Will focus.
We'll move on to question number 6, Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Justice Secretary has had with Police Scotland regarding potential station closures in Edinburgh.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, I have regular meetings with the Chief Constable where a range of issues are discussed, including the police estate. Police Scotland's 2019 estate strategy outlined plans to replace outdated, underinvested and underused properties so they could develop modern premises capable of delivering effective and efficient public services to meet the needs of people and the staff who use them. We are, of course, supportive of this, and I agree with the Deputy Chief Constable Malcolm Graham, who said that the presence of policing in communities is not defined by buildings, but by the officers and the staff and the work that they do in communities. And of course, co-locations often make best use of the public sector estate and offer the opportunity for increased visibility, closer working and increased collaboration between partners, Police Scotland. And of course, Police Scotland has over 60 examples of successful co-location.
Thank you. Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer and make her aware that these closures would potentially mean communities such as Leith and Portobello in my region being left without a local police station? And police stations are a vital point in our communities to ensure good relationships between the police and our residents. So it's not a surprise that Unison has said that these closures might deliver balanced books, but it won't deliver better policing. So what assurances can the Cabinet Secretary provide the Chamber that as many police stations as possible will be saved from these closures, and how Police Scotland are ensuring they develop strong relationships with communities and residents to tackle crime and keep people safe? And she's talked about hubs. Will she talk about where those are going to be in Leith and Portobello so that
Thank
people
you,
Ms. don't
Boyack.
Miss out on our police?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it is recognised that these are matters of extreme interest to local communities, and that people very often have strong views about the location of public sector buildings. And that's why Police Scotland are currently consulting on its estate plans. That will, of course, help inform future decisions and the details of future discussions and decisions that take place by Police Scotland. Because this, of course, is quite correctly an operational matter for the Chief Constable. But from my perspective, perspective, it is imperative that the estate meets the needs of modern policing and that the estate is fit for purpose for 21st century policing, but that also includes visibility and engagement at the heart of our communities.